So there's a review of Cosmic Sin that just says, where there's a Willis, there's a way.
Are you serious? Wait, yeah. On Letterboxd?
Yeah, on Letterboxd. Here, let me send it to you.
That's funny.
We got to make our account and then like his comment or like his review.
Oh, yeah. Scott Lister.
Yeah, Scott Lister. Wanted to give a shout out to our Lister, Scott.
Yeah.
Wait, your listener? No, no, he's our Lister.
Get together, have a few laughs.
Uh-oh, shit, lady, do I sound like I'm ordering a pizza?
Lady, put the freaking gun down on the ground right now. Take your son across the freaking street and say until he's gonna get you.
Hello, and welcome to Where There's a Willis, There's a Way, a film podcast about the multitude of works by Bruce Willis. My name is Josh Carter.
And I'm Kendrick Martin. Today, we will be covering Air Force One, directed by Wolfgang Petersen, written by Andrew W. Marlowe. This episode is part of a special series where we talk about other movies from the 90s, so we have some context for the decade as a whole in filmmaking. Normally what we do is we talk about a Bruce Willis movie, go over his performance, the film, add the movie to our rankings, and then we do the Wheel of Willis. This is the second of four episodes in our 90s reviews, so if you're dying for more Bruce Willis, just you wait.
You can find our more Bruce-centered previous episodes over at williswaypod.com. Find other episodes in the Last of the Action Heroes podcast network over at lastoftheactionheroes.com. Remember to rate and review us on iTunes and share this with your friends. Everybody needs a little bit of Bruce Willis in their life, and you know, even though we're not bringing that to you today, we have in the past, and we consistently will in the future. So,
plus,
you know,
even if we're not going to talk about Bruce Willis in this movie, we'll still bring up his name a lot in this podcast.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, for sure.
Yeah, he's the patron saint of the Bruce Willis podcast.
Yeah, and rumor has it he'll visit us in a future episode. That's not going to happen, but, you know, rumors spread,
hey,
so.
Yeah, I don't know where rumors come from.
Yeah, that's true, you know. A little birdie told me. That he's going to appear on a future episode, so.
Wow. Well, I'm glad you can talk to birds.
Yeah. That's the last time I listened to birds.
Yeah. Do you think they got the name Twitter from that phrase, a little birdie told me?
I'm not sure, actually. I think that the reason for that probably exists out on the internet, but, like.
Who's to say?
Yeah, who's to say?
I mean, who's to say?
Who is to say?
So as Josh mentioned, if you want to support this podcast, the number one thing you can do, head on over to iTunes and Apple Podcasts. Leave us a star rating. Write us a review. Spread that love around. We also now allow you to monetarily support us by heading on over to anchor.fm/Willis-Way. Before we get into talking about Air Force One, we're going to give you our ranking up front. And like I said, we're going to be talking about a movie with no Bruce Willis, but we still invoke the name of Bruce Willis to rate a non-Bruce Willis movie. So, Josh, Bruce Willis out of a Bruce Willis, what would you give Air Force One?
Yeah, so I want to emphasize that The Bruce Willis ranking system is like how much we recommend the movie and then the quality to which we recommend it. So once it's over a Bruce base, that means we recommend it. So this has to be at least a Bruce base. And dare I say, I think that I would actually give this movie a Bruce Will. That is two L's that you're hearing. A Bruce Will is what I'm giving this movie.
Two L's, you say? All right.
Two L's, yeah.
I am going to give this movie a Bruce W. I think it's definitely worth watching. But I have a lot of things that I did not like about it. So we will get into that.
That sounds good. I'm excited to talk about it because that's a little bit of a difference as far as that goes.
Yeah. I mean, I still think it's like a classic. Everybody's heard of it.
Yeah. Are we just going to, anytime a Gary Oldman movie comes up, we're just going to have terribly diverging opinions on it.
I mean, these aren't that divergent. They're a little divergent.
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
I was hoping that this scary old man would go on and escape to start his Fifth Element empire.
Oh, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But no, yeah. That's... Spoiler alert, that doesn't happen.
Spoiler alert, it doesn't become a crossover with the Fifth Element.
No, no. What year did the Fifth Element come out?
The 50s, I think.
It came out in 1997.
not in the 50s?
No, I'm just ignoring that joke. It's not even a joke. If I don't admit it's a joke, it's not a joke. And Air Force One came out in 95?
97, I think.
Oh, wow, man. Gary Oldman had a busy year. Yeah, you're right, 97.
Yeah.
Big year for the old man.
For the old man. When does he actually become Gary Oldman Oldman?
Like probably,
at what point?
If I were to guess, without looking at his IMDb page at all, my guess is going to be The Dark Knight. Or Batman Begins, I guess, was the first of the series.
That's when he becomes an old man?
That's when he becomes an old man.
Oh, okay. Batman Begins, so like 2006?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. So he's like late 40s at that point?
Sure, that sounds right.
Okay. All right. Fair enough. Fair enough.
Do you have something? Are you what?
I think of old man, not like Christopher Plummer shortly before he passed, but like somewhere in between current Gary Oldman and Christopher Plummer before he passed. Yeah.
Okay. Well, I still don't quite understand, but that's fine.
Yeah. That's fine. That's fine. That's fine. Obviously.
This is definitely something we talked about ahead of time.
Yeah, we wrote in here, do a bad bit about Gary.
Mm-hmm. Gary Oldman.
Old man.
The question is, when does William H. Macy just change to Bill Macy? Ever? Probably not.
Billy Max. That's what I go by.
It's funny. I sometimes get William H. Macy and Gary Oldman confused in my head. They're obviously very different actors, but sometimes when I'm trying to think of one, I just picture the other. And then in this movie, they're both in it, and I'm like, what?
This movie has a lot of who's who in it. But we are getting ahead of ourselves. If you guys ever want to reach out to us, feel free to send us an email at williswaypod@gmail.com or tweet at us or follow us on Instagram at williswaypod. And then you can also post on the Last of the Action Heroes Podcast Network Facebook page. And on that Facebook page, there's also a link to our Discord where you can hop in there and chat with us about any Bruce-related things or any action-related things. We would be happy to get some engagement on there if you have any Bruce Willis related stories that you want us to talk about or anything like that. Feel free to throw them in there. Preferably like news stories. Don't just give me like your fanfic unless it's like really good, in which case
I
guess
give me your fanfic and I will give you an honest opinion. So the Discord we have is fairly new. We just kind of spun it up and there's a channel for each of the podcasts on the podcast network. Join in. Chat with other people. That's what chat rooms typically are for, but just making sure people understand what a chat room is.
Mm-hmm.
It's for chatting with people.
Mm-hmm.
And posting links. We'll also put the link on we'll put the link to join the Discord at Willis Way Pod also. So
yeah. Yeah. Cool. And before we jump into Air Force One, we're going to take a quick break. This is Josh from Where There's a Willis, There's a Way. Check out other great podcasts on the Last of the Action Heroes Podcast Network.
Secret Agent Man.
Tonight I come to you with a pledge to change America's policy. Atrocity and terror are not political weapons, and to those who would use them, your day is over.
In a speech tonight in Moscow, the president issued a direct challenge to terrorist nations around the world.
But the question remains, what are the risks involved in such a bold policy initiative?
They hated your speech, didn't they?
They're afraid we won't have the guts to back it up.
Air Force One clear for takeoff. Thank you for your hospitality, Moscow.
How the hell did this happen? How the hell did they get Air Force One?
Your national security advisor has been executed.
He just bought you another half hour.
Sir, your parachute.
I'm not leaving without my family.
You know who I am?
I'm the President of the United States.
That audio was from the trailer of Air Force One. I'm going to read the description from IMDb. Communist radicals hijack Air Force One with the U.S. president and his family on board. The vice president negotiates from Washington, D.C., while the president, a veteran, fights to rescue the hostages on board. I thought it was going to be while the president, a veteran, and somebody else, but no, the president is a veteran. Okay. While the president, a veteran, fights to rescue the hostages on board. And you can find this movie on VOD.
I assume you've seen this movie before.
I had, yes.
Yeah, I think almost everybody has seen this movie before. I don't know of anybody that's our age that has not seen this movie. I'm actually surprised it's not easier to find.
Yeah.
You'd think some ad-supported streaming service would just have it constantly, but nope.
Yeah. None of my roommates have actually seen it, so it might be of, if you're a guy, you're more likely...
Oh, that's fair. That's fair.
If you're an action movie fan or a guy our age, you're probably more likely to have seen
it. This definitely, very much is the definitive 90s action movie formula with... Mm-hmm. The bad guys are Russians. The good guys are the Americans. And there's lots of explosions.
Yeah. And more muzzle flares than you could possibly prepare yourself for.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So yeah. I did not think about this when we picked this movie to talk about on this list. But as soon as I started thinking about it, I obviously drew the connection from this to Die Hard.
Yeah.
This is very much Die Hard in an airplane.
Oh, yeah.
And I think when we did Die Hard, we talked about how it spawned that whole almost genre unto itself of Die Hard likes.
Die Hard on an X or in an X.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I think as a you know, formula, this movie definitely does a good job of kind of playing with those rules. You know, Harrison Ford is sneaking around the airplane trying to collect items to unlock doors, you know, very like video game-esque.
Yeah. Could have been a point and click adventure by Lucasfilm back in the day.
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
But I thought that was pretty interesting about how like much of a Die Hard movie it was.
Yeah.
This movie came out, what, like 7-8 years after Die Hard did? So it's long and it's far enough away that it doesn't feel like an obvious grab for that title. You know, it's December as we record this, Christmas time, and I just rewatched Die Hard again with some people.
Yeah.
That movie still holds up. Great.
Nice.
Great Bruce Willis banger. But the villain, plot, the whole, like, reason they do things, those bonds or whatever, still is just like, what are you thinking with just, you're going to cart off all these bonds? Like, come on.
Yeah. Same thing with this movie. There is some stuff that like does not make any sense, but at least it makes more sense than the fucking bonds or whatever.
Yeah, maybe. I think my biggest, I have a few problems, but with this movie, but my biggest one, or one of my biggest ones, is probably the complete like mustache twirling villain that Gary Oldman is.
Oh, yeah.
He, you know, wants to restore his nation of Kazakhstan by bringing back this like political, or this, you know, general who was somehow controlling the nation. I'm not totally sure what the geopolitics is going on in the beginning. Like, was he the president of a nation and then the US was just like, we don't like him, kidnap him?
Yeah.
Or was he a war criminal, or was that like a, I know that, you know, it's post Cold War, so yeah, the USSR is dissolved, but yeah, not entirely sure what was going on there. But
yeah,
Gary Oldman is just like, I will kill whoever it takes, children, women, yeah, all these people, just bam bam bam.
It is odd that in the movie where they'll do lots of other little things that link it to the period in time, like they reference like Saddam Hussein, mm-hmm, they talk about like other sorts of stuff that's going on at the same time, and then they the like main bad guys feels like they didn't really know what to do with them, so they just tend to not talk about them as much as possible, but then you're like confused as to what their motive is.
Yeah,
whereas like I get on like a base level, other than the bonds thing, I don't really get that, but I get that they're going for money in Die Hard.
Yeah, they just want money in Die Hard.
Yeah, I got that.
in Air Force One, they're just, it's just so completely undisguised, like, we are communists and we hate capitalist America. You kill people with your capitalism, so you're just as bad.
Yep.
And it's, yep. I was like, what the heck? And then there's a scene, it's in the trailer, but when he's like telling, you know, Harrison Ford's daughter, he's like, I have a kid too, so I'm not all evil. And she's like, you're nothing like my father. And my wife was like, what is it about movies where kids call their dad father? Like, do people say that in real life? Do people say father? That's such like a movie, a script writing thing. Like, this 8-year-old girl will definitely call her dad father.
Yeah. Yeah, that's pretty silly. I would say that the script writing is not one of the best parts about this movie, for sure. I think that all of those things are totally valid, but they're all like script problems. But I think that all the performances make up for it, because like, even though Harrison Ford is playing essentially like young Ronald Reagan-esque president, who's like, you know, America acted too late, next time I'm going to send us in earlier, and yada, 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 in like the first 5 minutes of the movie, and being all badass and stuff like that. Like, even though he's playing this really ridiculous character, he's doing it very genuinely, I feel. So I think that I can ignore a lot of shortcomings in regards to the script writing, where it makes up for it in other ways. So, yeah.
I mean, Harrison Ford definitely has a lot of charisma, and I think,
oh yeah,
that's why the roles that he's known for, he stands out because of that role that he plays.
Yeah.
But I just was constantly rolling my eyes at the the like America First politicking that's going on in this movie. Just it was just like blatant. And I'm just like, ugh. And then when it's like 30 seconds into the movie, they're driving through Moscow in the middle of the night, and like the whole city is just there waving American flags.
Oh yeah.
And I was like, who would just be out waving American flags just because the president goes by? Like, sure, go out and like wave at him, but if the Russian president drove through Portland, I wouldn't like go buy a bunch of Russian flags and be like, yes.
Yeah, this movie is pretty ridiculous in that way, and it's very, very like pro-America no matter what, and certainly a little nice piece of propaganda for the various military arms of the American system.
Yeah.
I mean, and even like, even drawing back to like what you were talking about with Gary Oldman when he's like, I mean, your father has killed people too, and whatever, when he's talking to the daughter.
Yeah, Boris and Natasha level accent here.
Yeah. But even when he does that, at one point they're like, he's our top Medal of Honor winner from fighting overseas in Vietnam. And you're like, oh, good. Yeah, let's make America the good guys in Vietnam. Like,
right.
That's a and really fucking good one.
Of course, every time you see a soldier, they're like picture perfect American soldier. You know, the pilots are just like, look at me. White man with short hair. Classic American soldier.
Oh, yeah.
So that part was pretty pretty rough.
Yeah. Although I did like that they kind of broke the mold a little bit in that they had a woman vice president. I thought that was a good decision.
Let's talk about that a little bit. Glenn Close plays the female vice president, and which I had totally forgotten about.
Yeah, same.
And the IMDb or the Wikipedia page calls out that she is the I don't know if it's ever mentioned, but that she is the first female vice president, supposedly like in universe. I don't know how we're supposed to know that, and I don't know where they got that note. But
it was a little tiny, like, whatever the fuck bottom reader thing on like the bottom of the CNN video in the background screen.
There was a novelization of this book that came out after. It came out about the same time. I don't know who wrote it. I just saw a notice on the Wikipedia page. It came out like the week before the movie did. Roughly the same plot. So I wonder if maybe that's called out in there. But her main role in this movie is to kind of coordinate the efforts back in Washington, D.C. And, you know, it's taken us, what, almost 30 years to actually get a female vice president since this movie came out. So something we've actually been able to witness in our lifetime. But I thought it was interesting how much there was that subplot of her ability to lead. And there was kind of like all these different people were vying for like telling her what to do and kind of being like, you know, you're not the appropriate second in command in wartime. And yeah, there was like a lawyer who was like, let me read the Constitution here real quick. And I'm like, okay.
Which I love that they had that. And they make a point of in like the goofs on IMDb calling out that when they read the Constitution or the 25th Amendment, they say that the second article they say that the real life fourth article is actually the second article. And you're like, if you're going to have it in your movie, why wouldn't you just make it say the fourth article? Nobody's going to be like, what's article 2 and 3? Why didn't they mention those?
I don't know.
Very silly to me that they go through like the length to do some of the stuff that they do in it and then not actually do it. Right.
Yeah. I do think that that was like an interesting way to kind of show, like, it could have been very easy for this movie to just have people back at Washington, D.C. like doing their jobs and not having any strife. Or they could have had her be like completely incompetent.
But she's
Die
not.
Hard. No, right. She like has to keep a cool head and, you know, walk the line between too dangerous and also letting this political prisoner go that the terrorists want. In Die Hard, all the. One of the big things about Die Hard is the incompetence of the entire police department.
Yeah.
And how smart the terrorists are, the burglars, whatever you call them in Die Hard. This movie definitely did not show that. Although, let's talk about the bad guy Secret Service agent.
Oh, yeah.
So there's a guy who's like the inside man who basically unlocks the gun cabinet and gets the terrorists the guns at the beginning of the movie.
Yeah.
I don't know so why annoying. After they like roped everybody up, they wouldn't just like be like, okay, come with us and help us. Like, why didn't they send him down to look for the, you know, president when he's killing people down there? Like, why not use him? Why just keep him with the hostages the rest of the time?
Yeah. And then why later when the hostages are like starting to escape and stuff like that, is he not just, I don't know, killing the president or whatever?
Yeah. Well,
his whole like plot point of being like the last person to survive, I feel like would make more sense if we knew why he betrayed the US in the first place.
Yeah. And so at the end, I'm like, okay, everybody is dead. If I were him, I would just be like Homer disappearing into the bushes right now and pretend I'm like the goodest, nicest Secret Service man. He never done a thing wrong in my life.
Yep.
And just hopefully this all blows over. But he like is being all sneaky and gets a gun and tries to escape. I agree. If we had at least seen like, oh, he's, you know, got gambling debts and has to pay them off, or he really hates capitalism or loves Kazakhstan. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Tell me, so you really like this movie. Tell me some of the things you really liked.
I think that one of the things that I really liked about the movie is I think that the casting is pretty much perfect all the way across the board. Like, I think that Gary Oldman is well casted, well cast. And I like his Russian compatriots. I think that they do a good job of looking menacing and stuff like that. One of the dudes who is the one that's able to fly planes is actually the landlord guy from the Spider-Man movies, the old ones with Tobey Maguire. So I was like, wait a second, is that same guy? And he's great at being like a more sensitive Russian who is still there to kill people and stuff, but he like doesn't shoot as many people and is mostly there to like get things done.
A more sensitive Russian.
I think that Jerry Goldsmith did a great job with the score too. Like we'll talk about the score later because there's a little bit of interesting trivia regarding that one. But I thought that it was, a great score, or a fine score for what they were looking for. I liked the action. It felt like frenetic and fast paced without being too confusing about what's going on. And I think that also the executions that are going on with the whole terrorist takeover feel like pretty spooky and scary and stuff like that. And Gary Oldman getting more unhinged as he goes along, I think is played really well. And the rest of the actors who are like the background actors and stuff do a good job of showing just how terrified they are of the whole situation that's going on. Like, you can definitely feel the tension and the dread of all the characters. I also wonder though, if part of our difference in like enjoyment of the movie could have been that I watched it like straight through and that there was a break partway through for you, because with like thrillers and stuff, a lot of the tension can be lost if there's a pause in the middle of it. So I wonder if that might be part of it. But yeah, I think that there's a lot of stuff for me to like, even though I can recognize that the movie is super cheesy. I just think it does a really good job at being the movie that it's trying to be, I guess.
I think for me, the I couldn't stop rolling my eyes at the American propaganda at the beginning. Yeah. Just the complete bananas like villain plot. Also, I did not like Gary Oldman's accent. I thought it was distracting.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It didn't bother me that much.
But all that to say, I still think it was like fun to watch, and I'm glad I watched it and glad we picked it. I just don't think it probably wouldn't be one that I would like break out every so often.
Yeah.
One of the things I thought was interesting, I didn't look before we started to see what this movie was rated, but I assume it's rated R.
It is.
But the opening scene is these special forces sneak into this presidential palace in Kazakhstan and like kidnap that guy. And they're just taking out guys right and left. And there was no blood.
Oh, yeah.
And I thought like, oh, maybe this is a PG-13 movie and they're just not going to have any blood. And then as soon as they get on Air Force One and start killing dudes and there's blood everywhere, I was like, oh, nope, never mind.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that the starting scene is relatively tame so that you are like, oh, God, later.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah. And it's not like super apparent there's no blood. It's just there's a lot of people getting shot.
Yeah.
And it's very bloodless. And then for as bloody as it is, then when they get to Air Force One, I was just kind of like, wow, this is quite a shift. But you might be right. Maybe it was supposed to like really denote how the people on the airplane are in much more close combat. I know that airplanes are big, but man, when they're wandering around that airplane, I was like, holy cow, this, I know it's like, actually they used a real airplane for this set, although it's not the same airplane as Air Force One. It's a different type of Boeing. Could not believe how, big that airplane was. Also, speaking of things that made me roll my eyes, when they almost landed in Germany and then were able to take off again, I was like, no way. Is this possible? Those airplanes need so much like well-paved road to take off that they're just like driving through grass
grass and hit some trees and stuff.
Yeah. They're just like, oh, let me pull the takeoff switch. Here we go. Okay. Like, come on. I know it was like great tension building, but.
Yeah. I was mad at that scene, not going to lie.
I was like, what the heck?
There was a few scenes that I was pretty mad at, and that was one of them.
I think, so this, they talk about how there's no, no playbook for this plan of Air Force One being, kidnapped or taken over, whatever you call it.
Yeah.
I wonder if that's true. I assume that there's some play in somewhere sealed up that's like, if someone takes everyone on Air Force One hostage. You would think that Air Force One, of all planes, they would have like a kill the engine switch that you cannot like restart them, that they could have just flipped as they were landing.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's a movie. It's a movie. Eh, it's a movie.
It's a movie.
It's a movie.
Yeah.
What did you think of the ending special effects?
God. That's one of the things that makes me mad about this movie is that they kill their main bad guy and then there's like 20 minutes of movie left to deal with them landing and then, oh, they can't land and then go 20 knots east and then, oh, no, we have to... I can't fly planes even though I'm a licensed pilot. I can't do this plane. You have to have the president who hasn't flown anything but a helicopter fly it. Like,
yeah.
Yikes. What the fuck?
I did like the scenes where they're calling like NASA to walk him through how to let all the fuel out.
Fuel out. Yeah, that was great.
And just like, oh, we got to call these NASA guys who are in a hangar because that's where you have to be to take this
call. Where you live if you're NASA.
Yeah. Look, we saw Armageddon. They're just finishing telling Bruce how to drill because it's made of rock.
Can you imagine that both of these emergencies are going on at the same time?
Oh my gosh.
Just like, how was your day at work, honey? It was terrible. First, there's a space rock coming in. Secondly, the president's plane got hijacked, and I had to tell him which wires to pull, and his call dropped. It was horrible.
Yeah. Yeah.
I almost killed the president because I couldn't talk fast enough.
Yep. And then that scene where that lady has to fax. She's like, we can fax them. Like, yes, this movie is so 90s. I love it. And she has a little like, I'm so glad you didn't abandon us. Man, I would not vote for this guy again. He is a bad president.
Yep. Yeah.
He's a world leader. He's responsible for lives of billions. And he's like, nope, sorry. I need to stay here.
I think that his whole family aspect really plays well with that. Like the fact that he's trying to protect his family the whole time, I think, is the only reason why you buy it.
Yeah, right.
Because I get the feeling that, like, if at the beginning his family had gotten in the little escape pod with him and gotten flung out, that he'd probably be like, well, I will deal with this situation remotely, but I'm not going to be anywhere near the same amount of, like, have all that internal character tension and stuff like that.
I wonder what would have happened in this movie if he did escape and then he would have like snuck back aboard, you know, Air Force Two, the sequel. He sneaks back aboard.
Did you know that Air Force Two is actually a thing?
Yeah, it's the vice president's plane.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, another part that made me roll my eyes was when that ending airplane is like, we're changing our call sign to Air Force One. And I was like, oh, you
that
goofballs.
That is what happens.
You
that
goofballs.
Is what happens, though.
Yeah, but it's so goofy.
It is goofy. It is goofy. Speaking of goofy, I wrote down a couple of things that I wanted to mention. At one point, towards the beginning of the movie also is set up in a way to where, like, it benefits people that wouldn't have seen the trailer because there's quite a few twists that happen in, like, the first, I don't know, 40 minutes. And then after that, it plays out straight, which is, like, the exact opposite of what you want to do for your twists. Like, there's stuff that is surprising if you haven't seen the movie or haven't seen it in a while. But then after about that point, you kind of know who's good, who's bad, and where all the chess pieces are and everything like that. Mm-hmm. But right when you figure out that Harrison Ford is still on the plane, they have the scene where a general's like, well, there's several reasons why he might stay up there and be fighting. He was a Vietnam veteran and got the most kills or whatever, and his KDA was really good, and his aim percentage was incredible or whatever.
He teabagged the most bad guys.
He got several multi-kills and a no-scope snipe. So, like, there's all these – there's this whole exposition bit where they explain, like, why he would stay up there and fight, because you don't know that he's a fighter before that moment. And I feel like this movie would have been better suited with him, like, not even doing the whole negotiate with terrorists thing at the beginning, which – it doesn't really play out for anything for like, oh, he learned his lesson by negotiating with the terrorists, except for he didn't. I don't know. It's stupid. You could have easily shown him, like, maybe he's on a hunting trip and it shows that he's really accurate or something like that. That way you have this idea in your head and you don't have to have this clunky dialogue explaining it. You could also show character stuff there. I don't know. It was just weird.
So that was one thing I was confused about. The beginning where he gives a speech and he says, like, we'll never let a terrorist nation go on. We'll intervene sooner. But that doesn't really have any – that doesn't matter to anything.
No,
like,
it doesn't.
That's such a big deal. But he's not talking about negotiating with terrorists. That was like a pre – that's been a thing from before this.
Yeah.
And he obviously wasn't talking about – taking down this general guy, because again, that happened before the speech. So I guess we're supposed to just assume that he's like pro American in enacting justice or something. Like, I don't know.
Yeah.
I was, it was such a big deal was placed on that speech. And then I thought, oh, that speech is going to have to come back in play. But nope.
You know, like the rules that have been set up by filmmaking and art as a whole, so that if you mention something, it should either advance the story or, you know, show somebody about the characters or whatever. Yeah. Did you also like it when the president was wandering around the ship and then he wanders into the product placement room with Bud Light beer, Bounty paper towels, and Green Spring milk?
Yeah, and the orange juice, the Minute Maid orange juice or whatever.
Yeah.
And he's like, oh, this Minute Maid orange juice is leaking. That gives me an idea. Also, like, the fuel can leak just like this Minute Maid orange juice.
Wait, how much better would it be if we had an edit where it was like he sees it leaking and then the next moment you just see somebody using the restroom, like, and you realize that he had to go pee.
Yeah, yeah. And or then he's just like drinking out of the leaking bottle, like, man, I was thirsty.
Oh, it's so good. It's so good. It is a good moment that shows him thinking through like what he can actually do, because I mean, I would imagine that the president wouldn't be thinking through all these things until he has to think through all these things.
Totally.
And then
it's definitely, that's like the great thing about Die Hard movies, Die Hard likes, is they, you know, people are problem solving kind of on their own, trying different things and changing the plans,
talking in Russian to that one guy. Although that is something that that opening speech does do, is that it establishes that he knows some Russian.
Yes, but not a lot, because he still has to use a translator phone.
Yeah. Yeah.
But anyway.
One other thing. Oh, yeah. So my like biggest frustration with this movie as far as the plot goes is towards the very end of the movie, they're like, well, we've got to hook these planes together via this long zip line, and like, we're gonna send people down so we can send them back.
But then, yeah, I know, like 20 I was minutes like, earlier, they'd use parachutes. Why are they sending so many guys? I said the same thing. I was like, why didn't they just bring them more parachutes?
Send a couple of fucking parachutes and you're good to go. Like,
but they were over the Caspian Sea, which you know, harder, less safe to parachute into the ocean. But yeah, I had the same thought. Like, this is a really weird and contrived thing. They still could have had the same tension where, like, maybe one of the parachutes is broken and then bad McBad guy tries to get it and then something happens and he can't get out of the plane and he dies in the plane crash. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, I guess we got to see him tie two planes together.
Yeah. Which is apparently a thing that you can do, but then when you fly people back, you have to have the plane that is in front go to the back so that it can catch people, because people can't fly against the wind.
Yeah.
They just lower the plane a little bit, and they're like, yeah, they fall forward through.
Yeah. Well, they were already so low, too.
Yeah. Oh, man. That's great.
Good stuff.
I wanted to talk a quick second about another pretty giant plot hole, where the Secretary of Defense is like, well, in matters of national defense, I'm the one who has the final say in this in the president's absence. When, like, I don't actually think that that's true. Like, from what I've read, I think that that's more of like an advisory role that then carries out the orders that the president gives. So just like doing his own thing doesn't make any sense. And he also doesn't really push that hard for it. He pushes in like one scene and then that's it. But with that said, he does bring up the idea of invoking the 25th Amendment, which says like, hey, if the majority of the cabinet say that the president is incapacitated and it has to be like ratified and stuff like that, then the vice president would then become the acting president and then could make decisions as president. But in the movie, they're like, she's like, no, I won't do it because I have faith in the president. When that is like the dumbest thing ever. she should 100% have signed it, because even later on when the president uses his like ability to you know, have that whole personal favor to get that Russian bad guy out, whatever the fuck his name is, communist bad guy.
General so-and-so.
Yeah, General so-and-so. When he arranges for that release, it's just like, hey, I'm your old buddy, Jim. You want to let him out? And then he's like, yeah, sure, no problem. I'll negotiate with you. And it doesn't have anything to do with him being the president. It just had something to do with like him owing him a favor or whatever.
Yeah, because she tried. She, the vice president, Glenn Close's character, tried. She called up Moscow, and Moscow's like, nah, no thanks.
Not feeling it. We don't talk to women here. Like, yeah, I don't know. It's so weird that she didn't just invoke the 25th Amendment, because he doesn't need to be president while he's out there on this plane. That makes no sense.
Yeah, but Josh, you're supposed to have faith in your president. I don't know. I'm kind of curious. I know that like the vice president isn't like second in command in the military. Mm-hmm. So I wonder how accurate that whole like Secretary of Defense, you know, Pentagon kind of thing is there.
Yeah. Well, I think my point is that if this was ever happening in real life, where they're like, hey, the president's plane might have been captured, we haven't gotten any response out, it would be like, boom, 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 boom. Letters are signed. Papers are signed. Vice president is acting president. Like, there would never be this conversation about who's in charge in those, like, 5 minutes or whatever. It would just be like, we need to get this signed as quickly as possible so that the person who is in charge is the vice president. So, yeah.
But, Josh, this is Hollywood.
I know, I know, I know. I also was bummed out that this movie has 20 minutes of movie after they do the whole Gary Oldman dying, but then there's no scene of like Harrison Ford talking to Glenn Close and being like, thanks or whatever, and yeah, I'll make you acting president so I can go take a vacation or whatnot, because he even mentions a vacation earlier, so they could have brought that back. And I really wanted to see
what a great
those
scene it would be if he just walks up to Glenn Close and goes, thanks or whatever.
You know, I'm a big fan of just writing shorthand, so hopefully if I was actual screenwriter, I would remember to go back in and edit it from thanks or whatever.
This movie changes from like action drama to just like a mumblecore movie where he's wearing a hoodie, thanks or whatever.
Starring Pete Davidson as the president of the United States or whatever.
I'm going to go listen to some music. See you later. Okay, before we move on, I wanted to point something out. So in the credits, there's a character named Willis.
Oh, really?
And I was like, well, 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 funny seeing you here. I don't know who Willis was. And his character, or the actor playing him, is a guy named Jim Harley.
Mm.
And he has no picture in IMDb. And if you look up Jim Harley on Google, it shows a man, but also Jim Harley was apparently a European footballer. And so I'm not entirely sure that this picture that Google just throws at me is him, but I don't recognize. He was in Jurassic World and some other, Lost World, Jurassic Park, the sequel, Jurassic Park 2. So he's been in some other movies. But it's just funny how his character's name was Willis. It's pretty far down the credits too. So, you know, it's in like all these unnamed people.
That's funny. I wonder if they did it as a tribute at all to Bruce Willis, or if that's happenstance.
Oh, and don't forget Lee Ferrata played Russian bad guy.
That's so good.
Yeah, that's a great little credit.
You might have seen me as Russian bad guy.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's so good. I had a couple of other things that I wanted to talk about, too. Trivia items, if that's okay.
Go for it.
All right. So first off, I mentioned it earlier, but Jerry Goldsmith did the score for this movie. And apparently he replaced the original score pretty late in the game. Like the original movie was scored by Randy Newman, and the director was just like, this isn't the right score for the movie. So then he hired Jerry Goldsmith to do it, and he only had like 12 days to write the music for the movie. Wow. And he hired like somebody to help write music based on some of his musical cues, and did it. And he was like, yeah, I'm never doing a replacement score ever again. And he was like older at this time too. So I would imagine that would be batshit basically.
That sounds rough.
Yeah.
Randy Newman, like the singer, he does movie scores.
Yeah. Yeah, he does. Wow. So he did the score to like, Monsters, Inc. and a bunch of other movies. And his brothers actually are all like composers or musicians.
Interesting.
And I think their dad was a musician too, or a composer, and their mom was somebody famous as well. Interesting.
I did not know.
Yeah. Like I think
today
one of the Newman brothers scored like the old Heathers movie, and one of them scored The Player. So yeah, there's a lot of Newmans out there in the composing world. But yeah, I listened to
it's
some
an
of...
old man and a new man.
Yeah, maybe that's why they couldn't do it. They're like, this is too much. Too much man on this. But yeah, I listened to some of the Randy Newman score, and it's fairly cheesy, so I think that they made the right call. And Jerry Goldsmith, his score feels very big and epic, and so yeah, I think it was good. Another thing that I wanted to mention is when they released the Russian prisoner, whatever the war hero's name is.
General so-and-so.
General so-and-so. They were like, well, we need to get a really terrible, grim-looking prison, like super dystopian, end of an empire-ish. So naturally, they decided to film it in Ohio, in a prison that had been shut down 7 years prior due to a class action lawsuit alleging inhumane conditions. And so that's where they filmed it. They looked to the U.S., the greatest country on earth. That's what we are.
Mm-hmm. Great for prisons.
Great for prisons historically. Mm-hmm. And then my last little bit of trivia is regarding our favorite Gary Oldman Oldman. On set, he was nicknamed Scary Gary by people who worked on the set. And you would think that he was like some sort of character actor or method actor, but he wasn't. He did not stay in character and would routinely make jokes in between the filming of it. And he and Harrison Ford actually joked around a lot on set. And I was researching Gary Oldman, and one of the things that I saw is that he was in a Guns N' Roses music video just a few years prior, where he's credited as playing the devil. And I was like, what the hell? So I started researching this music video, and I watched it, and it's bizarre. But according to Slash, Oldman allegedly was on a massive amount of cocaine at the time that he did that music video shoot.
The music video?
Yeah. And then insisted on doing his own makeup for the shoot, entered rehab shortly after the filming was done, and does not remember his time on set at all. So,
wow.
This is a clean and sober Gary, and I thought that he did a great job, although your mileage may vary.
I mean, I didn't like his accent, but otherwise I thought he did a great job.
Okay, nice.
I mean, but my problems with him were not his fault. They were definitely like writing problems. But
yeah.
I thought he played a very scary Gary.
Very scary Gary indeed.
Yeah.
Scary Gary, Oldman, old man.
What is he like, a Beatles now?
I don't know.
He is British. Does he have an accent? Like a real life British accent?
Yeah, he does. I mean, and I think he uses his normal accent in the Harry Potter films, because he plays... He plays Joking Black, or no, Sirius Black. So
joking black. He's got such a affected way of talking, like his voice is so recognizable that I guess I never like put it together that that's like an accent. But now that I think about it, it totally makes sense. In this movie, his accent's fake, obviously, because he's not really Russian. But
yeah, and like one of the first movies I saw him in was Batman Begins, where he uses a pretty good American accent. Yeah. So yeah, he's a talented actor.
Yes, he is. We should do a Gary Oldman podcast.
Oh yeah, that'd be great. Maybe we'll do that when we're old men. So we'll do the old men, old man podcast.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Old men on old men.
Yeah. Who better to talk about old man than old men?
Yep. Mm-hmm. Perfect.
Classic.
Perfect. Classic. Sponsors, you're piling up in the emails. I can already hear it.
Yeah. Anyways, so in as far as the money goes for this movie, the movie spent $85 million and then it brought in $315.2 million.
I'm really glad we moved away from your whole big ones and little ones.
Okay, so the reason why I had to move away from that is because when I was listening to the podcast episode, because Kendrick edited it, so I always try to listen to those, I was literally crying while trying to drive in the rain, and it was too much wet in front of my eyes. So I had to move away from the big ones discussion. If you would like me to bring that back, please send us in an email.
Yeah, I almost cut it out because it is so confusing, but I couldn't because it just went on for so long and we never really recovered. 70 big ones and 13 little ones. And then you're like, oh, no, I can see why you might be confused.
And then I was like equally, if not more confusing after it. Oh, Jesus.
If you're not familiar with what we're talking about, well, that's a good reason to go back and listen to last time's episode where we talk about Ronin.
True.
Woo. Yeah, so say again the actual box office for Air Force One more time.
$85 million spent, $315.2 million in.
Wow, that is a healthy return.
Yeah. Yeah, it's almost shocking that there weren't more of these movies considering the return. Like, honestly.
This movie is definitely not written at all. I would say it goes to the movie's credibility that there is no hanging thread for a sequel.
Yeah.
You know, we often see that in big movies as they kind of want to create a franchise out of it. But you're right. It is surprising that they didn't really go on to do much more. The director of this movie, Wolfgang Peterson, has done some other big, well-known action movies. Das Boot being his kind of one he's got most acclaim for. That came out in 1981. But he hasn't done anything in a while. I think
he did something in like 2016, but he had taken like a 10-year break before that. So,
yeah, his last movie, yeah. Air Force One was like five movies ago on his director list. So that's four things in the last 30 years. So.
Yeah.
Okay. Should we move on to the Star Trek connections?
Yeah, that sounds good.
So this movie has two Star Trek connections.
Two plus.
Yeah. The first is a man named Harry Hutchinson. And his Air Force One character is Rammstein Air Base Controller. So he's one of the guys at the German Air Force Base where they almost land. And he was in a episode of Deep Space Nine playing a Bajoran trooper.
Nice.
He was also in an episode of Babylon 5, Home Improvement, Sybil, and ER.
Nice.
I know this is the Star Trek connection, but I'm also doing the Star Trek's connection.
Oh, good.
really expanding it out here. But the other one, which has a bigger role in both Star Trek and Air Force One, is Bill Smitrovich. Smitorovich. I'm not sure how you pronounce his last name. He in Air Force One plays the General Northwood, which I think is the general who is arguing with the vice president about like who to take over and who should be doing this, and we can't let anybody kind of like telling him how airplanes work, that general. In Star Trek, he is was in several episodes of Deep Space Nine, and he played a character named Michael Webb in a two-parter episode.
Nice.
You know Deep Space Nine more than me, but I believe this is the two-part episode series where people go back in time to like the 2030s in San Francisco, and there's like a...
What's it called one more time?
The episodes?
Yeah.
Past Tense, parts 1 and 2.
I think so.
They go back in time and are dealing with like some atrocities going on in 21st, 22nd century San Francisco.
Yeah.
So, yeah, those are the Star Trek connections.
Yeah. And those episodes are fun to watch because a lot of the stuff ended up coming true, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Yeah. I had one more Star Trek connection too. And
oh, nice.
That is the composer, Jerry Goldsmith. He composed several different Star Trek series themes, as well as was a composer for a bunch of the movies. So he composed the music for, going back all the way down to the bottom, he composed the music for, did the conducting on Star Trek The Motion Picture. And then he composed the music for Star Trek V. He composed the music for Next Generation. He composed the music for First Contact, the movie, Insurrection, the movie, and the Voyager theme, and Star Trek Nemesis, the movie. So
I wonder...
did a lot.
I wonder, and I don't know how music composing works, so if you're listening and you can fill us in, you know, send us an email, but I wonder how much of those he actually contributed to versus like creating some of the music that all Star Trek kind of plays into its music, you know, like they have they have bars in Star Trek that are from the original series that they just kind of weave through stuff like that. So I wonder how much he actually worked on all those versus how much he just was like, they use my stuff. So I gave him a little advice. But still, great. He has a, you know, long list of things that he's credited to. So
yeah, for sure.
Yeah, cool. Anything else you want to say about Air Force One before we wrap up?
I don't think so. No, I think I'm good. I think I got all my Air Force One out of me.
Nice. Excellent.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for listening to Where There's a Willis, There's a Way. You can find previous episodes over at williswaypod.com and send us an email, williswaypod@gmail.com, or follow us on the socials at williswaypod.
And for those of you that have listened in for a while, every episode we try to end with a little sweet treat to close out the show. So a sweet treat can just be any sort of recommendation for anything in particular. Kendrick, do you have a sweet treat that you wanted to shout out this episode?
I do, and that is the works of Georges Méliès, who is a French filmmaker who is one of the first filmmakers in history. And if you go on YouTube, you can find a whole bunch of his works, and they're all, you know, between 5 and 15 minutes. And they're all silent films with music over top of them. His most famous being Voyage to the Moon, which is the one where the rocket ship crashes into the eye of the moon. You've probably seen the artwork of that used elsewhere. But I just recently watched kind of a series of 10 of them not too long ago. And there's Wikipedia pages usually about each of them, can give you some ideas on the plots. They are bananas. Some of them have like very contrived, like fantasy science fiction plots that I'm like, oh, I think I understand. And then I read the Wikipedia page and I was like, whoa, this is way different than what I thought it was. So yeah, George Méliès. You can look his stuff up on YouTube.
And you said that he's French, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. That makes sense that the plots would be confusing.
Mm-hmm. It is really cool to see. I mean, I love like the how movies are made stuff. And it was cool to see him. Because I did some of the stuff when you're a kid. You just like are playing around with cameras and what kind of special effects. And you can see him kind of like creating sets and then like stopping the camera and removing the set. And that's how like stuff disappears. And the special effects are like kind of hokey, and it's most of the time it looks like it's just filmed on a stage somewhere, like a play stage. So yeah, it's really great. If a good companion piece to this is the movie Hugo, that came out, I don't know, 8 or 9 years ago, about a boy in a French train station, and he falls in love with movies and watches a bunch of Méliès's works. So yeah. Mm. I'm in a film club with some people, and the person whose turn it was to propose us to watch something picked all those. So I got the opportunity to watch them, and it was great.
That sounds really cool. Thank you for recommending those.
Yeah.
And I'm assuming that we'll put that in our show notes too. So if people want to catch those.
For sure.
You can do that. For my sweet treat, I wanted to shout out some other movies as well. I am at this point in a time frame where the newest Spider-Man movie has not come out yet. Spider-Man Home Alone, or whatever it's called.
Spider-Man Home Alone.
There's like crossovers with other Spider-Man characters and stuff like that. So I've been rewatching
for Spider-Man movies, but okay, keep going.
Well, I mean, like, they've had them in all the posters and stuff like that, so I don't know.
Some people don't like to get spoiled, Josh.
All right, fair enough. A new Spider-Man movie, and in anticipation of watching it, I have been rewatching all of the old Spider-Man movies. We haven't gotten to the Amazing Spider-Man yet at this point in time, but I watched all the Sam Raimi Spider-Man films, and those are so fun. I like them a lot. So I wanted to shout out the Sam Raimi Spider-Man films as my sweet treat. Go catch them. They're kind of hard to find, unfortunately, unless you want to pay for a VOD. But you can find them in basically any used movie store, because they sold a lot of those, and they're everywhere.
I meant to tell you, so over the Thanksgiving holidays, I was in Bend, Oregon, and... Yeah. I've been to Bend many, many, many times, but I never went to the last Blockbuster. And this time I was just down the street from it. So I was like, well, we got to go to the last Blockbuster. And so, went and checked out the last Blockbuster in the world here in Bend, Oregon. It's pretty great.
Oh, yeah. Is it like a movie store, or is it?
It has the feel of Blockbuster. Like, there are movies for rent, there's new releases, there's like old DVDs you can buy, there's also like kind of a little museum at the back wall of like movie props and some stuff. Cool. But otherwise it's just a DVD rental, and it actually was pretty busy. There was like, I don't know, 10 people in there wanting to rent movies. So
wow, that's really cool.
I think one of the things that surprised me about it was the streaming titles on DVD, like streaming TV shows, you know, like Netflix produced TV show or something. People out there who maybe don't have great internet or don't subscribe to Netflix want to watch that. There is a DVD release of it, and you can just go to Blockbuster and rent the DVDs for like a Netflix show.
Wow.
I was like, wow, I never thought about that, but that's pretty crazy. pretty neat.
Yeah, that's great. That's great. The more that we can have more people access like movies and TV shows and stuff like that without being locked into, you know, certain streaming platforms, the better. So
totally.
Yeah.
All right. Cool. Well, I think that's going to do it for us today.
Correct. Yeah. I was going to say the same thing. If you want to follow me on Twitter, you can do that by following at Joshing Carter.
And you can follow me on Twitter at K Martinix. Next time, we're going to be covering the movie Clueless.
Woo! I also haven't seen this one, so do you want me to make any predictions about this one?
Yeah. Yes, please tell me what you think Clueless will be about.
Okay, I think that Clueless...
I have not seen Clueless in a long time, but I do really like the movie.
Okay, I think that Clueless is going to be a movie where they're going to do a reference to the game Clue, and at some point they will be looking at or playing the game Clue. I think that this movie is going to... have a a setting where somebody learns something and there's going to be a mustache twirling villain.
Okay, so what I have is there will be a reference to the game Clue. It will have a setting or somebody learns something and a mustache twirling villain.
Yeah.
Perfect.
So tune in next time to see how many of these I get right.
Yeah. A setting where someone learned something. That's like a pretty specific guess. I can't believe you are, you know, taking that kind of risk.
Yeah, I know. You know, I've never seen anybody learn anything in any movies before. So. Yeah,
especially not in a setting. Like, that's that's the big one.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Well, until then, have a great rest of your December, and we'll catch you guys later.
Thanks, everybody.
Goodbye. Did we have any emails? I haven't looked at that yet.
Nope. Not a one.
We need to mess up some more.
Yeah, what's what is going on with you, Josh? Why haven't you been flubbing it?
I don't know. I don't know. I'll try really hard to mess up this time. I could do something like misquote an amendment or something, and then I'm sure that people will get after me for that.
You should go into great detail on the politics, or not the politics, but the legalities of what goes on in this movie.
I actually have a big segment devoted to that in my notes.
Oh, good. Good.
We're going to get back to Professor Josh. It's been too long since he's made a visit.
Professor Josh. Professor Josh.
Clap, clap. Welcome back to Professor Josh. It's me, Professor Josh.
As I said last time, your hayseed is showing.